Hi, my name is Betty Diaz, and on behalf of Paramount Veterans Network, welcome everyone to another exciting virtual coffee with vets. This time, we're going behind the scenes with the new show, Beyond the Edge, which premieres tonight. Today's special guest is Craig Morgan, who's a country singer, you just heard him now, and contestant on the show. He's also a veteran. Thank you for your service, Craig. We will also have the president of Operation Finally Home, Rusty Carroll, who will join us a little bit later. But before we begin, let's take a look at the show's trailer.
Oh! I'm Mauro Ranallo.
Matt Mitrione!
Normally, you'd see me announcing from some of the biggest and most brutal sporting events ever.
It's over! Mamma mia!
Let me tell you, that is nothing compared to where I am now. Deep in the heart of the Panamanian jungle. It is here that nine celebrities from the worlds of fashion, sports, television, and music are about to go far beyond their comfort zone.
I feel like we're all still a little bit terrified of what's ahead of us.
They're leaving behind their families.
I'll miss you.
Their careers, their worlds of luxury.
All to enter this remote wilderness where they will live for the next 2 weeks.
The jungle is really getting to all of us.
Fucking diarrhea. Check into that for 2 weeks.
They'll push their minds.
This was not as easy as what people think.
Bodies.
Jungle is just throwing everything at us.
And spirits to the limit.
I keep hearing these bats and they're freaking me out.
Because each day they endure out here.
I was literally laying in water for like 7 hours.
They'll earn money for their charities.
I've never given up. And I'm sure as hell not gonna do it now.
Why would they do this? It's much easier to write a check.
It's because this group of celebrities share a common mission to prove that if we all work together, we can accomplish anything for the greater good. So let the adventure begin now!
Going into the world!
The celebrities will also compete against one another as teams. And with each new adventure, the amount they can win gets bigger and bigger.
Congratulations, $40,000! $60,000.
Nearly $750,000 is on the line.
That's why I wanted to win.
But if a celebrity reaches their breaking point,
maybe you're all right.
This is the thing that might make you go.
They'll ring the bell and go home.
I'm ringing the bell.
No, you're not.
At the end of the competition, the top two earners will compete in one final adventure.
Miguel, so much. You're not quitting on me.
There can only be one Beyond the Edge champion.
If I had the option to go be with my family and see my son and my daughter, I'm out.
Who is it going to be?
This is Beyond the Edge.
Wow. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to our moderator for the evening. You may know him as Sonny Quinn and his infamous one-liners and nicknames on Paramount Plus's show Steel Team. Please welcome AJ Buckley.
Hey, everybody. I just really wanted to say thank you again to the BetNet for inviting me to be amongst such great company. And Mr. Morgan, Craig, it's an absolute pleasure to meet you. I've been a fan of your music for a long time, and to get to chat with you today is a special thing. So I just want to thank you for being here today. Thank you for your service. And for anyone who doesn't know about your military background, can you maybe just share what branch you were in, a little bit about your military experience?
Oh yeah, easily. I was in the Army active duty for almost 11 years of active time, and then about 6.5 years of active reserve time. Assigned to every element from the 375th Ranger Regiment, 82nd Airborne Division, 101st Air Assault. Was in Panama in 1989 for the ousting of Manuel Antonio Noriega. all over the world. I was a 13 Fox, for those that don't know, those military personnel watching do know. I was a forward observer, calling for and adjusting indirect fire assets. I was the guy that went out with the people out in the front and told the people in the back where to put the bullets, the big bullets, as you may be aware of. Yeah. Great job. Loved my job in the Army. And I tell people all the time that being in the Army helped prepare me for this music business stuff.
Yeah, right. That's a whole nother level right there. We just saw the clip from Beyond the Edge, and you look at something like that, and you think in your mind, what is it that just makes you want to go do that show? Because that there's parts of that just does not look fun.
Well, I'm going to tell you, the clip they showed us before we went and did this did not look like that. It was all, it looked a lot different. But you know what attracted me, and I think having spent so much time with these other personalities, what attracted me to this show were two things. One primary attraction was the charity component. Mm-hmm. Knowing that everyone there, every day that we stay and every event that we win, we raise money for our charity of choice. And the second component, and this may be the more important component for me, believe it or not, was the fact that we're all raising money for our charity and none of us are trying to vote off or get rid of the other people. So for me, it was, you know, if you think about our military operations, our objective was to get everybody in and everybody out. This was the same thing. Going in, everybody there was thinking, you know, we're still wanting that. You know, you want everyone to stay. But you also know that I knew about the brutality and everything about this environment, having been there before. I knew that it was going to be tough. But at the same time, man, I was, you know, when we first were looking at this, I was training for an Ironman. I felt like I was in great shape. I don't sleep a lot anyway. I don't eat a whole lot. Yeah. So I felt like I was kind of prepared for it. I was just, my biggest concern going into this was wanting to make sure that I was doing everything that I can and utilizing the knowledge and the experience that I had about the environment and so on and so forth to try to help everyone else.
Being that you said you'd been there before, you'd served in Panama before. So what was it like actually going back shooting a show there? But, you know, the intel that you probably had prior to of already being there must have helped in some sort of way, or maybe not.
Oh, no, it for sure helped. I mean, you know, knowing I knew that time of year, I had a working knowledge that it's going to rain every night. I don't think anyone else was expecting that. It's Panama, beautiful, sunny Panama. But I knew that it was going to rain every night. So I knew that. I also was very aware of all of the harm that's there, the critters, the snakes, the spiders, the scorpions, the trees, the leaves, everything there wants to sting you, eat you, or bite you.
Is it the real big spiders, not the little spiders we're used to, but like the big?
Both. There's one spider there.
I'm out.
There's one spider there that's, his body's only about that big, but his legs are this long. Yeah. It's the freakiest thing in the world. Yeah. And even worse for me are the bats, the vampire bats. So these bats will sneak in. Vampire. They'll land beside you and sneak up on you, and then they lick you with the saliva that kind of numbs you, and then they bite you and let the blood drip out, and they just sit there and lick it off. Yeah.
What?
True story.
Did you have a chance to meet up with any celebrities before starting the show and give them any intel on the vampire bats?
No, you know, that was another thing. We didn't really know who else was going to be there until we were getting there. I actually arrived in Panama City like a few hours early, and I ran into Mike Singletary. And I was kind of excited to see Mike because I knew Mike. He and I have done some speaking engagements and things together. So I was really excited to have somebody there that I know and that I looked up to and admired. And both of us are going, hey, do you know who else is coming? You heard anything? We didn't know nothing. All we knew was we were going into the jungle, and that we were going to be trying to survive and raise money for our charity.
Wow. So when you were there, were you the sleeping accommodation? Were you tense or was it more like Survivor or what was it?
Well, they were bamboo huts with no walls, just a floor really, made out of bamboo. You know, if you split bamboo down the middle, it's kind of rounded, and you put the two together, so you got this kind of rounded thing. Super that was our beds, our floors. That's what we slept on. And we had to make roofs over them with the palms and all of that kind of stuff. Now, again, mind you, I've done this before. You know, I train people how to build shelters in various environments. So I was completely confident in my skill set. Just wasn't. I'm going to say I might have been a little ignorant. I thought everyone knew a little bit about that, but that's not the case.
Yeah. You know, it's crazy. Just, it was true when, like, so stuff like that, it's like, when the, even like the start of the pandemic, when I learned how, I knew a couple things, but I learned how much I didn't know. You know, yeah. It was like, people were freaking out over toilet paper or certain things. It was like, okay, well, what's the bigger picture? It's a crazy, when you watch shows like this, it's one of the things I love, because you're like, oh, wow, that's how, you know, that, you know, these are the things that you need. These are the basic, it just goes down to the fundamentals and stuff, which is crazy. So how did everyone react? Was there anyone that really surprised you that, you know, over the course of the 2 weeks that really stood out?
I mean, if I'm going to be honest, everyone surprised me, because, again, having a working knowledge of how difficult that terrain, that environment, how it is. And then meeting everyone and, you know, having these initial perceptions, I think it was good on the creators, producers, and directors, whatever, on all their parts, not allowing us to know who was coming beforehand, because that way none of us had any preconceived ideas about who was going to be there and what they could do or couldn't do and any of that stuff. So we were just learning each other, and some of them were just learning the environment as we're getting into the jungle. But I will tell you, as I met these people, you know, initially, you know, you got a couple ladies from New York, LA, and I'm thinking, boy, this is going to be tough. But I was amazed at how strong, and I mean, there were some real warriors in there, all of them, not just the ladies, the men as well. You know, some of the guys had not been in any type of an environment like that. But you got to take guys like, you know, Mike Singletary and Ray Lewis. These guys have been beat up and beat each other up, and, you know, they can take a beating. You know, those two guys can take a beating. But what I didn't know was how they were going to react to the howler monkeys and to the snakes and to the spiders and to the cold and the rain and the sleep deprivation, food deprivation. You know, those things, they can impact on the strongest of minds.
Is it the mental game that really kind of kicks in there?
Oh, 100%. But again, everyone really surprised me. I mean, I've played those physically mental games for a long time. Mm. For me, my hobby is to go to Alaska and live off grid. I mean, you know what I mean? It's my world. That's what I absolutely love. Doing that with a bunch of people is different, though. I'm just here to tell you. It's easy. It's easy when you're by yourself to take care of yourself. But I truly, and I don't know if it's the military or what, but I felt an extreme obligation to ensure that I was doing everything I could to help everyone else, because the better everyone did, the better it was for me as well. And again, that's unlike any of these other shows.
Yeah.
You know, normally you're trying to get everybody out of there. This was the opposite. And every time, every day everyone stayed, it increased our chances of winning, being on a winning team and winning more money for our charities.
Now, is it true, like, you're only as strong as your weakest link, sort of saying that they say, like, in those situations, like, has to be sort of have to get the team on the same page as everybody to sort of get through it?
You know, most leaders, most trainers, most survivalists, everybody would say, yes, what you're saying is 100% true, that you're only as strong as your weakest link. But I'm not a fan of that saying, I got to be honest, because your weakest link may be your weak link today, but they're your strongest link tomorrow. So what you do is find that happy medium between your strongest link and your weakest link, and that's your point. And that's what you strive for. So if we, you know, if you're running and we have some, and you're someone's on your team that does not run, you better figure out a way to compensate for that. And, you know, and here's what's unusual. You don't know who's on your team until the, you know, an hour before you go do your adventure.
Well, and the fact too, that you don't vote anybody off, you know, that there's, and this is for the greater good. It's like you guys, there's that common thread of coming together and working and figuring it out. So like, I like that perspective of where you're saying there, you know, today you might be the weakest link, tomorrow you're not. So there's that revolving door, which makes it really for a compelling show. I'm a huge MMA fan, and Marwan Olivo. Okay, what was he like? I mean, I just love his voice. His on any of the MMA stuff, he's just so passionate and gets into it. But how is he in the jungle?
I too am a huge MMA fan, and I didn't germ him too hard or nothing. But like everyone else is there, is just a room full of superstars, you know. And when Mom walked in, I was like, oh. Well, I'm going to talk to him. But he was absolutely amazing, extremely gentle. Everyone will see how he has such a great ability to communicate with people. Yeah. I could also tell, Mao, he feels everyone else's pain. So when we would have conversations, you could see the intensity of his understanding of everyone's pain. It was just, he was amazing. And again, he wasn't one of the cast, but he was very much part of the family.
Well, I think that's what makes him such a good MMA commentary when he gives us post-fight interviews and fighters have lost, but he's able to like capture something great and find these athletes that have, you know, are at their lowest moment or at their highest and get a narrative out of them. So I'm excited to see what he does with the show. So while you were there, what was the food like? Did you have to eat anything gross or?
What was the food like? Well, it consisted of bananas, coconuts, snails, fish, whatever we could scrape up out in the jungle.
So you guys were completely on your own to go hunt and gather and get it done.
We were expected to go find our food. Wow. And I spent I can't tell you what I did. Yeah. We were expected to find our food.
And did you know that going in there, or did was that like a surprise when you got there? You're like, oh, okay, there's no craft service.
I felt like that's what was going to happen.
Yeah.
Like I said, when we first talked about it and we were first discussing the show, I was asked, you know, how would you feel about having to build your own shelter, find your own food, survive out in the wild? Wow. You know, and so I felt like that was what was going to be expected to some degree.
Now you touched a bit on how your military experience prepared you for, or helped prepare you for this show. But, you know, you've had such an amazing music career. How has your military experience been sort of implemented into your music career?
Well, I'll attribute it to the music first, the songs.
Yeah.
Just like any other part of my life and just like anybody else's life, a lot of times writers write based on experience. They utilize stories from their life to create the material that they want to write and sing about. As artists, as there are songwriters who aren't entertainers, and all they do is write songs, and they really write about, you know, experiences, life, things that happen. And so for me, having been in the military, I had a lot to draw from. Now my career as an entertainer, how the military affected that, you know, I don't like being late. I expect my people to be on time. Which is, quite honestly, a lot of the things that the military does that I've carried forward into my music career, my business, is not always the case with all artists, you know. having said that, you know, it's I think like anything anybody does in life, whether you grow up in the Midwest and you work on a farm, or in the South and you work on a beach. If you do something like that, anything, no matter what it is, long enough, you're going to have experiences that will help you in your future life. You should.
Yeah. And on your last album, it's actually the song that we heard at the beginning of the show, which is fantastic, Sipping on the Simple Life. You wrote that with two active duty Army Rangers. How did that come about?
Oh, so I was actually at a USO show in Washington, D.C., and I was just there to make a presence and speak, and these two guys were there. They got invited to sing. They were working at the time on trying to be a duet, considering getting out of the Army. Wasn't sure exactly what they were going to do. And then they came up to me and said, hey, we're going to write a song with you. And I said, yeah, cool. You know, let me get your information. I'll try to get back to you and we'll see if we can make something. And they're like, no, we want to write with you tonight. I'm like, it don't work that way, bro. And they said, come on, man. Army Airborne Ranger, you got to write with us. You have to do it. And I'm like, oh, no, it don't work that way, bro. And they were, you know, two young captains, and I was an NCO. I was being the key word here. And but anyway, eventually they convinced me to sit down, and after a few glasses of wine or four or five, we wrote a song. And I will give Andrew the credit. Andrew and Justin, they had been working on the idea. They had the idea, Sipping on the Simple Life. And when he told me the hook, I just said, yeah, let's go ahead and do this. So we sat down with Mike, who was my guitar player at the time, and the four of us wrote the song.
Wow. Oh, that night?
That night. Well, within an hour or so.
Are you serious?
Oh, it's hard. I told him I have a flight to catch. We got to make this quick.
That is amazing. Wow. That just makes that song so much cooler. And you got a memoir coming out this later this year, which I love the title of it, God, Family, Country. Will you be sharing some of your experiences of being in the service in that book?
Oh yeah. In fact, the majority of it is about my time in the service. I would say, you know, as the majority of my life was there. At this point, it's getting about, I'm about the halfway mark. Mm-hmm. I've been in the music half of my adulthood, and I was in the Army for the other half of my adult time. So yes, a whole lot of my experiences from the Army are in the book. A lot of stuff that people don't know about me. I've been doing this music for almost 20 years now, and after 20 years of music, doing a lot of radio interviews and television interviews and being asked a lot of questions, you can say the first thing only so many times, you know. But there are some firsts in this book that I've never talked about before, some of which I didn't discuss because I wasn't sure if they were things that I could legally discuss, some operations that took place while I was served in the Army. And we ended up writing them and getting the approving authorities to okay everything. I didn't write anything that I thought would be detrimental to anyone in the military or any operations or anything like that. But I was very fortunate when I was in the Army to get to do a lot of fun, cool stuff.
I'm looking forward to it. When does it actually come out? Is there a date?
I think September, like third week of September, the book will be out, but I think people can pre-order it right now.
Awesome. Anywhere, Amazon, or where would they go to get that?
Yeah, they can get it anywhere. That's what I'm gonna say.
Okay, you'll get that one. If you look at the whole experience up until now of being on Beyond the Edge, what would you say was your biggest takeaway
from Beyond the Edge?
Yeah, Beyond the Edge.
The people, man. I you know, and it might sound a little cliche, and I don't want to do that, but I got to be honest. I was so impressed with the people, and here's what I've learned, and this was the biggest impact of this thought process for me, aside from the military. And I'm careful to say this. I wouldn't want anyone, especially my brothers and sisters in arms, to think that I'm comparing living in the jungle to being in a combat environment, because I'm not.
Yeah.
But there are some similarities that take place in both environments. And there's a reason for that. And this is my analogy on that. When you're in combat and you're in a foxhole, or you're standing at the corner of a building about to run around that corner, and it's hot, and there are bad players on the other side wanting to do bad things to you, that group of people that's with you at the corner of that building, or right at that door when you're about to go in, or where the foxhole or whatever it may be, they don't care about your race. They don't care about your religion. They don't care how much money you got. They don't care about none of this stuff. All they care about is whether or not you got their six. And they know that because they've been with you enough to know that they love you in spite of all those other things. out there, that's, we were in an environment where all of those exterior elements were ripped away from us. No one cared that Paulina used to be a supermodel, is a supermodel, I should say. No one cared that Ray Lewis is this famous football player, that Jody was this famous actress, or Lauren and myself were singers. No one cared about those things. It didn't matter how much money everybody had. It didn't, none of that stuff mattered. All that mattered was taking care of each other and getting through that, the adventures. And when that happens, you see people's heart, and there's a lot more heart and a lot more positive stuff out there than we allow ourselves to see sometimes because of all the interference in our lives.
You just gave me goosebumps, man. I love that. I think if anything, that's with all the craziness that's going on in the world right now, if you're going to turn on the TV, you want to see stuff like this. You want to see people coming together and as humanity and working together and working through problems and, you know, work the problem and work as a team and figure things out. You know, I hope they use that soundbite a bunch, because whatever you just said there was on point.
Well, it's sad. What we have to figure out, though, in this world, and especially in this country, we have to figure out, how do we get there without having to get there the way we get there now?
Exactly.
It takes really bad crap for us to come to that point where we forget about those exterior things and come together. We're seeing, you know, there's a really bad crap going on in the world right now with Russia's invasion of the Ukraine, all out invasion of Ukraine. But what we are seeing is the love from the country surrounding and the support and the coming together. But it shouldn't take something so drastic for us to have to come together.
Amen to that. I agree. Could not agree with you more. Now, one of the great parts of Beyond the Edge is how everyone came together and was raising money for charity, like you said. You're raising money for your charity. You want to tell me a little bit about your charity and why you're working with the charity.
I'd love to. And I'd love everybody while I'm talking to get out their checkbooks and wallets and credit cards, get ready to make some donations. That's why I did the show. Operation Finally Home is the charity that I chose for this. And I work with some other charities, but obviously the Operation Finally Home has a special place for me. Because of their work with veterans. What they do is they provide mortgage-free homes for veterans and their families and or their families. But they do something different. And some other organizations out there that build homes, and they do a great job. But the difference is, and what I love about the concept behind Operation Finally Homes' ability is to bring the community in. It's local plumbers, electricians, carpenters, even realtors. They all from the community that are working to get this home for this veteran. So in the process of doing that and over the time it takes to accomplish that task, they're creating a bond between the veteran and the community. And I'll be honest, it's one thing to hand a veteran a home and a key and say, thank you for your service. And that is a big deal. That's a great big deal. But it's an even bigger deal to hand them a home and the keys and say, thank you for your service and welcome to this community. And that community is a part of their life from that point moving forward. And they're a part of theirs. That's a big deal.
That's a beautiful thing. And we have the president of your charity, Operation Finally Home, Rusty. So I'd like to welcome him to the chat right now. Welcome, Rusty.
Greg, how you doing?
I'm good. So your charity, we just spoke a little bit about it, but there's some more you'd like to add of how you got involved and how you both of you joined forces and give us a little backstory.
Sure. Thank you all for allowing us to be here. But as Craig said, Operation Finally Home, we're a national 501c3 nonprofit that works to build hope in providing homes and home modifications to wounded, ill, and injured veterans, first responders, and their families. And as Craig said, it's not Operation Finally Home that does this work. We really work with the building community and the community at large to incite this builder community to come together to work to raise funds, products, service, financial donations to build and modify these homes to provide a home and security and hope that these veterans or first responders didn't have prior to dealing with their injury and illness.
Is there a story or a proud moment you could share with us that you've had over the years with the charity?
You know, we're just honored and blessed to be able to do the work that we do and be in a position to help those that have served us so unselfishly. But I think the two things that stand out to me is seeing God's hand in the work that we do. It brings people together. It brought us to Craig because we were on parallel paths and we just kind of met in the middle on a project in Warsaw, Indiana. And Craig's not going to do anything that he didn't want to do. So we were honored to know that he believed in the work that we did. Otherwise, he wouldn't have come alongside us in the manner that he has. But the other is really just seeing the hope, the certainty that's restored in the eyes of these veterans and their spouses to know that they're now going to be provided a home or accessibility is going to be provided for their home that they haven't been able to utilize and see that physical transformation in these families as they go through the construction process because they're just completely overtaken by the news that they're going to be receiving this home because we surprise them with that news and then they get to go through the construction phase to see their home come to life. Wow. And when they get into a particular stage of the home and it's dried in, we'll go through and have a notes of love event where we bring the community in where they'll write notes of thanks and scripture and be what it may in these homes and they will stay there forever. But these veterans and their families get to see these as they're walking through and once they're in the home and they know they've been there for a while, they know exactly where some of these notes are and see the love and the comfort and the support that the community has given to them is still with them years after they're in that home.
What did you think about when you found out Craig was going on the show and was gonna represent your charity on such a big platform as Paramount and how big and how much they get behind the veterans and what was going through your head the moment you found out about that?
Well, I was certainly surprised and honored that he was going to be raising awareness and telling the story of Operation Finally Home in hopes of getting other builders and donors and particularly bringing veterans' attention to us. But knowing that Craig's down in Panama, that's just another day for Craig. That is, he's in the woods. I mean, that didn't surprise me at all.
There, I love it. You're in Alaska? What, you're in Panama? I love that. Now, with the money that is raised, how does it affect the veterans? How do you funnel it through the charity?
Sure. Well, what we'll do is we'll go through and have a town hall meeting for each one of these projects where we're garnering support through the builder and their subcontractors and the like in hopes of garnering product and service donations, and we're able to raise roughly 2/3 of the value of the home cost through that product and service donation piece. So we'll have to fill the funding gap with that, with funds that are raised. And this is gonna fill in the gap for one, if not two or more homes for us to be able to build homes for these families. So it's gonna change lives. And that's what's so exciting about this is to know that the fun and the work that's going in right now, it really is gonna save and change people's lives.
So there's something, you know, I've learned over a couple of years with doing the show SEAL team and getting to know a lot of to veterans and stuff. And there was one thing I've taken away from it and will carry for the rest of my life is that, you know, especially nowadays with people having such platforms to speak, you know, the freedom of speech and to be righteous about something, to march about something, whatever it is that they want to do. The reason all of us have that ability is because the sacrifice that the men and women in our country, what they've done, have given that. So I with my kids, how I'm raising my kids, my friends and family, you know, some type of veteran charity and find a way to give back and thank them for the ability to have the freedoms that we have today. Because unfortunately that gets lost with some of the younger generation. So if somebody out there is listening right now, how do they find you? Where do they go? How do they get involved? How do they help? What do they got to do?
Well, first off, if a veteran is in need, whether they be reaching out to us or somebody else, reach out for help, whether it be in support of taking care of your spouse physically, your physical needs, you're dealing with PTSD, reach out. There are people and organizations that want to help you. They want to help. But as far as reaching out to us, we would ask you to go to our website. That's the best place to go, operationfinallyhome.org. You can learn more about our organization, how a builder can get involved, how a donor can get involved. And we also work to connect veterans to other service organizations. While we provide housing, we know that there are some other needs that they have, and we'll work to connect them with other organizations. So operationfinallyhome.org, as well as watching, seeing us on all of our social channels, whether it be Facebook, Instagram, or LinkedIn.
And that's for volunteers as well. All that they can go.
We're donors, builders, supporters can all go to that, and we can be able to get connected with them and get them connected with projects that are going on in that area. Or if they want to start one in their area, we'll work, come alongside them to help get a project going in their area.
Well, I couldn't encourage, you know, anybody that's watching more, because it's really changed my life and sort of how I see the world. To get involved and some way, somehow, and say thank you by action, not just an Instagram post. It's important that we get out there and have boots on the ground of volunteers and really show up for the men and women that have done so much for our country. There's a question for Craig. Would you ever do this again?
You mean beyond the edge?
Yeah.
I think I would. Initially I said no. But I probably would. You know, the physical and mental aspect of it for me were, again, part of my life. It's part of the way I've trained and live still today. I will say the only thing that was different for me was it was a lot of work put into this. On the CBS part, the cameraman, and I do want to say God bless those people, because I know they worked very hard to do everything that they did and not be in our way, which was difficult. But there were times they were still there, and it made it different than if I were out there with people by myself. But yeah, I would do it. You know, anytime, I think all of us that are given the been blessed with a platform and opportunity, even if you don't have a platform, I think all of us should be doing everything we can to try to make this world a better place. And it is what it is. I'm saying that, and I mean it every word. Take every opportunity you can to try to make someone else have a good day. It'll come back around to you. And so, yeah, I probably would. I'd be willing to go out there and suffer again. In order to raise more money for another charity or even for Operation Finally Home again. That was the great thing about this. So even the days that if I competed and didn't win, as frustrated as I may have been about not winning more money for Operation Finally Home that particular moment, I was still excited and to know that another charity or other charities were prospering that day and that I still had a chance. So, you know, it's that thing called hope. There was always hope that I could do more and win more and do better. And I think that's something that needs to be shared. It wasn't the fear of not being there or someone getting rid of me. It was the idea of hope. And in that hope, I found joy for other people raising money for their charities. And I think we all felt the same way by this, you know, throughout this experience.
Well, Rusty, would you ever go do something like this?
You know what? I love being around my family. So I think it would be a little bit difficult, but I think that to Craig's point, knowing that there was a calling there and the opportunity to help others, I think that if I were provided with that call, I'd go. I'd go.
I love it. I love it. I got a little fun question. What, Craig, what is on your top two songs on your playlist right now?
Holy Water is one of them.
Nice.
Song called Holy Water. It just hammers me, man, when I hear that song. And right now, believe it or not, it's a song called Don't It Make My Brown Eyes Blue by Linda Ronstadt.
Nice. I love it. And then another one. What two TV shows are you watching these days? And I'm pretty sure you're gonna say SEAL Team.
Navy SEALs. Yeah. And Beyond the Edge tonight for sure. SEAL Team, man. I love to watch that. So I can make fun of the SEALs.
Okay.
Hey, they know all you Navy SEAL guys out there that I screw with. You know I'm joking. I love you. Much respect.
We got a couple guys from Delta that are on the show with us as well as tech advisors and the guy that plays Trent, Tyler Gray. So he's Delta. So there's constantly banter back and forth of like, you know, how they're holding their gun, how we enter the room, and they're just like, you know, and just but just the ball breaking that goes on between if he has some guys come visit or there's other team guys that come visit and they're just like yawn at each other. It is awesome. It's like some of the best back and forth I've ever seen. It's, you know,
great. Some of the most fun I have is spending time with a bunch of Navy SEALs. And when me and a bunch of the Army guys get together and there's a couple of Navy SEALs in the room, it's nonstop.
Oh yeah.
But that's fun. You know, yeah. That's the great thing. This is what I know. And I love this. I love this. We will bust each other up so much. I mean, to the point to where sometimes there's some pushing and shoving, but you let someone outside of that organization or outside of that group of people say something and boy, all of a sudden everybody gets real close and real tight.
Yeah. Well, I've been lucky. I've met some great guys along the way and, I've made some incredible friends on the show and outside the show. And I really, you know, some of the guys are lifelong friends now that I've had, but the one thing that goes back to what you said earlier at the show is that ability of just having guys in your corner, and just the humility and the stillness, you know, of advice. And also if I'm not pulling my weight, just the direct, like, hey, what are you doing? And it's that, what are you doing? I'm like, I have the nickname Soup Sandwich, and this guy Dan gave me
everybody's got a nickname too. They call you Soup Sandwich.
Soup Sandwich, because I got ADD and I forget things. I'm like, they're like, oh, soup. They're like soup.
Soup Sandwich. That's a good one, man.
Soup Sandwich. It was Delta. He gave me that name. He was like, you are a Soup Sandwich, because we're trying to learn a car interdiction, and I was like, every time I'd pull my thing out, I'd like the thing would. And then he's like, every time I went to go smash the window or cut the seatbelt, it was like, I'm like, where? He's like, he's like, soup, get back into that. Do it again. I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, yeah, how do you? It's like, these guys have gotten away 30 times. I'm like, it's a TV show. He's like,
well, maybe one of these days I can come out there and participate and maybe cameo or get a role or do something with you guys.
Consider it done. We got to get you out there. That's actually one of the greatest things on our show, is that the amount of guys that have been hired, and CBS has done an unbelievable job with this. That, you know, people give Hollywood a bad rap with their false promises, but I will tip my hat to CBS for what they've done with the vets and providing these transferable traits to the set. And we've had guys that were basically fresh from getting back, got a job. They started, you know, just doing whatever they did on the set. Then they worked their way up to in the writing room, now they're writing scripts. We had a veteran, Tyler Gray, who'd never directed a day in his life before. He was just a brilliant storyteller. And because he said while he was deployed, he just watched movies all the time. He understood story structure and telling a story and character development. And he turned out to be this brilliant writer. And he got CBS gave him an opportunity to direct. He's directed three episodes now and they're awesome. And I'd say over 50% of our crew are veterans. All our stunt doubles are former special operation guys. So they've gone out of their way to really open the door for men and women to come to our show and you come and you say you want a job behind the camera some way, they'll figure it out. So a big hat tip to CBS and CBS VetNet for just being outstanding in that department for the guys. I wanted to truly thank you guys for both being here tonight and CBS VetNet. Tonight, you got to check out Beyond the Edge. It's premiering tonight on CBS. We're all excited for everybody that participated and all the money that is being raised for charity. And as you said, just creating a show that there's hope and seeing people come together and work together is a beautiful thing. So I personally can't wait to check the show out. And absolute pleasure and honor to chat with you. And I hope I get to see you on the set. Rusty, pleasure to meet you, buddy.
My pleasure, man. I look forward to seeing you again for sure.
All right, guys. God bless, man. And everybody at home, thank you for tuning in. Thanks for joining us today. Hope you enjoyed it, had a few laughs, and make sure you check out the show tonight, Beyond the Edge. Thanks again, guys.
Hi, everyone. I just wanted to chime in because I know we have a couple of questions. All right, so I think you asked the first one. So Craig, did you get any inspiration for new music from your journey in Panama?
Yeah, actually, I think while we were there, I started a song or two in my head. The problem, like AJ said, I too have ADD. So I don't know how much of it will come to fruition, but Lauren and I actually started a couple things while we were there, but you just never know.
Okay, so a question from Cindy Hunt. I know your wife, Karen, Craig, was always very supportive of your military career. What did she say when you told her about this opportunity with Beyond the Edge?
Keep your clothes on.
My wife says too.
Shelly Griffin, howdy and greetings from Colorado. Thank you for this webinar. I'm super excited to watch the show. Thank you to all our veterans. She's a retired deputy sheriff injured in the line of duty, and her dad was a B-29 pilot.
Oh, wow.
There will be a recording. Follow Paramount Veterans Network on Instagram and we'll upload a video there.
That's awesome.
Molly, when the show was finished, did it take time for you to adjust back to your normal life, Craig?
I landed back home afterwards and had a show the following night.
I love it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Joni, will you be doing a book signing tour?
I will be doing lots of book signings. Yes. When they get out there, for sure.
Awesome. And then, Craig is asking, Craig, do you still have your shop in Dixon? If so, when are you and the family going to be there?
We do not, as I've gotten so incredibly busy, it was getting next to impossible for me to be there and continue that. And my children were busy with other jobs as well. So I hate it that we don't do that anymore, because it was a lot of fun and it was great for my family in light of everything that happened to our family and the reason we started that business. But no, we are no longer doing that.
Okay. And then a comment from Allison, not really a question, but got a kick out of Craig saying he had fun while serving. since part of what was fun about my time in the Army was meeting Craig at Camp Liberty in 2005 on the beginning of my first deployment, and then AJ about halfway through my second deployment to FOB Delta in 2009. Glad to see they're both still involved with the military community.
Camp Liberty, yeah, I was at camp. Yeah, that's right, 2009.
Yep. That's awesome.
With the three-star, it was a General Jacoby, a general, trying to think of the three-star that was there. That was my very first trip over there. Gary Sinise set that up for me. It's what I was doing.
Oh, that's awesome.
I was doing CSI New York, and he was like, I'd always ask him questions like, you need to go over. I'm going to set something up. I'm like, all right.
That's done. Awesome.
Yeah.
All right. I think that's all for today. Thank you.
Well, thank you all.
Thank you. Hey, and if Craig, you do any book signings down in Charleston in South Carolina, let me know. We'll meet up.
I will for sure, my friend.
All right, brother. Be good.
Godspeed, brother.
Yeah, God bless everybody.
Thank you all.
Take care. Rusty, take care.
Thank you, brother.